Hey, good morning, City Life family. Welcome to church. Glad you joined us, whether you're coming as a home group or a family group or you're watching online from far away. Welcome. Glad you joined us. I'm here at the Villa Rustica. It's basically some Roman ruins. It was an old house long time ago just outside of Dubrovka. And it reminds me of this story where the Hebrew people have come back from exile. And this is under the leadership of Nehemiah and Ezra and others like this. And the city of Jerusalem is destroyed, and they're rebuilding. And they're rebuilding the walls, and they're rebuilding the temple. And they begin with the foundation. They lay it out, and you have two kinds of responses to this. One was this group of people who were weeping because they'd seen the old temple. They knew what they had lost. And then you had this other group of people who are just rejoicing and worshiping, and they're all excited about what God is going to do. And I just was thinking about that and just kind of projecting, thinking out about 2021, this year that's in front of us. And I hope you guys had a great New Year celebration, by the way. But you know, we can look at the foundations, kind of what's left from 2020, and we can be crying, we can be weeping, we can be like thinking what we've lost, or we can move forward into 2021 with just joy, just worship, just looking at the foundations and thinking, you know what, this is what we're starting out with. This is the cards that have been dealt. But let's move forward with Jesus. Let's move forward with God. Let's see what the Holy Spirit's going to do this year. It's going to be amazing. And you know, it's up to you to choose which perspective you have. If you want to weep or do you want to rejoice? So it's up to you guys. So let's just move forward into our service, but also just into this year with expectation of God doing the amazing things. Okay. I just like to pray us in. Let me do that real quick. Lord, just thank you for who you are. Thank you that you make beauty out of ashes, Lord. You make glorious things out of the rubble, Lord. You are the God who reforms and creates, and you take the chaos and the darkness and you make beauty and you make life and you make this whole universe, you make creation, Lord. You do the amazing things, Lord. We just invite you to do that right here, right now, in this moment. We praise you. We say you're glorious. We say that you can take what is been rejected and make it beautiful and whole again. Lord, thank you for redeeming us individually. Redeem this year, redeem this very moment in your name. Amen, amen, and amen. Hey guys, we got some exciting things on this service. We're going to jump into worship, and then a little bit later, Lubos is going to lead us in the Word. And then at the end, I have a special announcement about kind of where we're going as a church and challenge you a little bit for 2021. So hey, let's jump in. God bless.
I'll leave it behind. Emmanuel, rejoice. He wraps himself in light, and darkness tries to hide. Trembles at his voice, trembles at his voice. Sing with me, how great is our God.
Dear Father, always near us, may your name be treasured and loved. May your rule be completed in us. May your will be done here on earth in just the way it is done in heaven. Give us today the things we need today, and forgive us our sins and impositions on you, as we are forgiving all who in any way offend us. Please don't put us through trials, but deliver us from everything bad, because you are the one in charge, and you have all the power, and the glory too is all yours forever, which is just the way we want it. City Light Church family, happy new year to all of you. So you're watching this on probably the first Sunday of 2021, and I am pleased and honored to be sharing with you today sharing a little bit of God's word with you. And when I was asking and praying about what to share with you today, the Father really told me to share with you about him, and specifically to tell you how much he loves you and how much he cares for you and how much he wants to do for you in terms of provision and protection. And I was already going to talk to you about the Lord's Prayer, and actually the Lord's Prayer, the name of it and the words of it have been really kidnapped by the religious spirit, where we just kind of repeat them almost exactly in a way as Jesus said we shouldn't. But I want to take a look at the deeper meaning of really what Jesus, how Jesus was teaching us to pray and how we should pray. The themes and the ways how this prayer can really unlock more of God's goodness coming to us. So let's actually start by reading from Gospel of Matthew and from the Message version, how Jesus really introduces this prayer and when he teaches us how to pray. So starting from Matthew chapter 6, starting from verse 5. "And when you come before God, don't turn that into a theatrical production either. All these people making a regular show out of their prayers, hoping for stardom. Do you think God sits in a box seat? Here's what I want you to do. Find a quiet, secluded place so you won't be tempted to role play before God. Just be there as simply and honestly as you can manage. The focus will shift from you to God, and you will begin to sense his grace. The world is full of so-called prayer warriors who are prayer ignorant. They are full of formulas and programs and advice, peddling techniques for getting what you want from God. Don't fall for that nonsense. This is your Father you are dealing with, and he knows better than you what you need. With a God like this loving you, you can pray very simply like this." Now I will actually turn to the paraphrase of this prayer that Dallas Willard offered in his book, Divine Conspiracy, because I think it can help us kind of see beyond the familiar words and take a look deeper at really what Jesus is saying and how he's teaching us to pray. So, "Dear Father, always near us, may your name be treasured and loved. May your rule be completed in us. May your will be done here on earth in just the way it is done in heaven. Give us today the things we need today, and forgive us our sins and impositions on you, as we are forgiving all who in any way may offend us. Please don't put us through trials, but deliver us from every bad thing. Because you are the one in charge, and you have all the power, and the glory too is all yours forever. And that is just the way we want it." Wow. What a prayer. And so different from how we tend to pray. But I wanted to go through this prayer line by line. And really really see how getting deeper into this prayer can bring us closer to God, to the Father, how praying these things, especially over us, can unlock more of God's goodness in our lives. The first line really just is an address, addressing God. And Jesus tells us to address God as Father, as our Father, as my Father, not just his Father. It's really the pose, position, the approach and attitude to come to God as a child. As a child comes to a loving parent, a loving father. As a child comes to a father who is there for them, who really their whole world revolves around this parent to a great extent. And a parent that provides, a parent that cares, a parent that really knows best what is good for their child. And just like, you know, my son oftentimes doesn't, or maybe if you're a parent, your children, they don't frequently realize that actually you know what's best for them, or you seek the best for them. So we don't frequently consider God to really know what's best for us, and or we don't trust his heart. But Jesus tells us to approach God as our Father, to approach him as a child who approaches the Father. And what's really often translated into English as a Father who is in heaven, really, actually, from the origin, better translation would be his Father who is in the heavens. The heavens in plural really would mean everywhere, starting from the very air, the atmosphere right around us, to the farthest reaches of the universe. And as Dallas Willard put it in his paraphrase, his Father who's always near us. Really, he's always available, always there for us, always in the very atmosphere surrounding us. It's full of God. We are full of God. And so, as we pray, let's address the Father as one, not that's far away somewhere in the skies, in the heavens, removed, barely touched by our prayer, by somebody who's right here, near us, very present, and very much involved in our lives, in our day-to-day, in the details of our life. So Father, dear Father, always near us, may your name be treasured and loved. And this is a request for God's name to be treasured and loved throughout the world. But really, first and foremost, let's apply that to us. Father, may your name, may I treasure and love your name above all else, may I love and treasure your name. Because God wants to be loved and treasured by us just as much as he loves and treasures each and every one of us, as he loves and treasures you. And to be honest, any things that we put above God, that we love or treasure more than him, stand in the way of his goodness flowing to us. If my child
prefers and loves, I don't know, video game more than me or what I have to offer him, then it kind of puts a limit, puts a boundary, puts a fence around, hey, yeah, I love you, but this right here is more important to me. This right here, and within these fences, I actually treasure more, and I don't want you to touch it. And so God really doesn't. He desires to bring His goodness, His love into all aspects of our being, all aspects of our life. But those places that we treasure and love more than Him, we kind of set off limits. So He can't. Yes, He can do everything, but in His omnipotence, He set up the ways things work to where He respects our choices. And those things that we choose over Him, those things that where we put do not disturb signs for God, He doesn't enter. He respects those. And so as we pray this prayer, may Your name be treasured and loved, let's apply that to us. Father, may Your name be treasured and loved by me, in me, over and above all other things. Help me to treasure You more than anything else, more than finances or money, more than likes on social media, more than family or even the time with family, of a lot of which we've been robbed off, so to speak, this year. What are the things in me that I treasure and love more than Your name, more than You? Expose those so that Your name may be treasured and loved above all else, in me, in my heart, by me. May Your rule be completed in us. Again, may Your kingdom come, Your will be done, as the traditional wording has it. First and foremost, in us, God's will is always the best for us. And so as we pray this, again, it's just more of an extension of the same thing. We are telling God to bring more of His rule into us. And here on earth, as it is in heaven, first and foremost in us, then in our kingdoms, in our spheres of influence, in our families, in our households, in our work, bring God's rule, God's kingdom. God's kingdom is where His will is done. This may Your kingdom come, Your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Is there just really in different words saying the same thing? Your kingdom come. And we first and foremost have the ability and the authority to bring God's kingdom into those places that we have rule over. And we say, God, Father, whatever my kingdom is, I want it to be part of Your kingdom. Whatever I have say over, I want You to have say over, so that it's not my will. Yes, it is my will, but my will aligns with God's will. My will aligns with Father's will. And we are telling God, and again, what are the things in me where God's rule is not yet complete? There's plenty. There's plenty in my life, and I'm sure there's plenty in your life. And as part of this prayer, or praying it even on its own. It's a very, very powerful prayer. It's like, Father, enter these places. First, expose where I'm not in line with your will. And once he does expose them, come into those places. Make them available to your kingdom. May your will be done, even in these places in my heart, even in these places in my life, in these places in my kingdom. Your kingdom come, your will be done in these places. Again, whether it's the finances, whether it's our relationships, whether it's our work, whether it's, what are those things that we are holding on to that we want to have done our way? Well, let's have done God's way. God, your will be done. Invite him. It's not about effort. It's about release to God and invite his rule into these places in our lives. Give us today the things we need today. Oh wow, just imagine how that would be if we truly trusted Father to provide for the day, each and every day. Yeah, there might be something put in store. There might be something that we expect to come our way, but really, it's about trusting that God is the provider today, and that he is going to be that provider tomorrow also. And so it's about what we ask, but it's also about what we don't ask. Jesus is telling us to pray here for the provision for today, not be worried about where tomorrow's bread will come, because we know that it's the Father who provides every single day for us. And just rest in that. And there's a lot more that Jesus has taught on this point about not worrying for tomorrow and about the lilies in the field and the birds in the air and how God takes care of them. And really, as we pray, just linger on that today. Father, dear Father, give me today what I need today. Because I know that tomorrow you will also give me what I will need tomorrow. And I don't have to worry about it right now. Not only is that freeing for us, but it also is a form of release, an opening that allows more of God's goodness to come to us. Not just in those specific ways that we are holding on to that we think he should be providing for us, but also in provision that's bigger and wider and more thorough, more complete than we could ever even think. Forgive us our sins and impositions on you, as we are forgiving all who in any way offend us. Forgiveness. Here's really maybe two options. There might be people like me for whom rule keeping is easy, and I need to, in humility, admit that, yeah, I also sin against God. I also trespass in ways that I may not recognize, might be a blind spot, but just the humility that, yeah, I'm not perfect. And I do make mistakes, and I do hurt God's heart at times. And be humble enough to ask for forgiveness in that. But also, and maybe it's exactly the opposite for you, that you are struggling with, as Paul said, you know, do things that you know are wrong and Don't do things that you know are good, and know that there is forgiveness. There is grace available where God the Father forgives us, and you can also forgive yourselves. Forgive yourself and also forgive others. And here actually, just after the prayer in the Gospel of Matthew, Jesus expands on this. And let me read that again from the Message version. So it's verses 14 and 15 from the 6th chapter of Matthew. In prayer, there is a connection between what God does and what you do. You can't get forgiveness from God, for instance, without also forgiving others. If you refuse to do your part, you cut yourself off from God's part. And again, it's not a rule, but it's a way things work. By when we hold on to the unforgiveness towards others, we block the goodness and forgiveness flowing from God to us. So let's let go of that unforgiveness. Decide to forgive. Ask God also to help us forgive as we ask and are willing to receive His forgiveness. Please don't put us through trials, but deliver us from everything bad. Some of us might be too proud to ask God to help us out from trials. We think that, hey, we've got it all covered. I'm good. But really, again, the humility is required to recognize that actually, without God's protection, we ain't good. We aren't. I set aside the pride and enter into humility, and I'm willing to ask God for protection, for deliverance from evil. I acknowledge that, hey, it's not all in my power, but also it will help me see all of those places, all of those times when God did show up, when He did come through, when He did rescue. And I will actually have the eyes to see that and thank Him, because He does. He does come through for you. He does rescue you in so many ways that we may not even realize. But as we humble ourselves and ask for it, we will also have better eyes to see and recognize when it happens and be thankful for it and feel the love from God coming to us. And it might even open up the possibilities of God to step in more areas, to rescue us in places where we thought it was all on our own. We were all on our own. But again, asking for the protection, asking for the rescue, will allow God to come through for us even more. And you might be thinking, well, I've been asking for God to help me, to protect me from this and to remove this from me, and He's not doing it. And yeah, I acknowledge there are times when it seems like what we ask for, we are not getting, despite all of the promises and the scriptures, and despite Jesus even teaching us about the heart of the Father. And yeah, there might be some unknowns, but even through those, we should still rely first and foremost on our Father and ask Him for the protection, as opposed to taking things into our own hands. Well, I've been praying and God did not come through, so I take things into my own hands and I'll take care of it myself. Well, there might be times when God is actually calling us to stand up and to do things for ourselves as he's growing us up under his loving supervision. But that's very different from taking matters into our own hands, pushing God aside, and saying that, okay, well, you're not doing this, so I'll take care of it. Again, comes back to the first point. Father, dear Father, who's always near, who's all involved. He's involved in the details of my life. What is going on here? What do I do? What steps are you asking me to take? What is my part and what is your part? So again, this prayer is something that's a treasure that most of us have not uncovered or maybe just scratched the surface. And so I invite you to dive deeper, to spend some time on this prayer, in this prayer, not repeating it 10 times or 100 times, but mulling over each and every line of them and how it applies to our life. What is the Father saying to me in every single line of them? So I pray that as we enter into this prayer, that we'll become more of children that are loved, that know that they are loved and they are provided for, that love their Father above all else and want His will to be done in every single aspect of our lives. Be children who trust Him to provide for every single need as and when it is needed, even if the provision doesn't come any minute early. Trusting God to love us even through our problems and even through our mistakes, and rely on that grace as we also choose to forgive others and extend that grace to others. And relying on God to protect us, to not put us through too much as He has promised. And look to Him to guide us through the everyday trials that He's growing us through, and rely on us, on Him to protect us from trials that would be too much for us. So Father, in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ. Amen. Thank you.
Excellent. I hope you guys were blessed. Hope you were encouraged. Thank you, Lubos, for leading us in that word. And guys, just, you know, hold on to that. You know, let's live it. Let's not just be hearers of God's word, but doers of God's word, that we would be connected to Him, that we would be constantly having a daily conversation, relying on Him, waiting to hear where His Spirit is leading and moving forward in that. Speaking about moving forward, I want to talk to you guys briefly about what is the plan for church moving into 2021. As you guys already know, this has been a kind of a rough year that we've gone through, and there's a lot of unknowns moving into 2021. But there's a few things we've announced this before. We're going to say it again clearly, that as a church community, we're kind of in a new phase, a new thing, and it's a lot of unknowns. But the reality is right now is we're going through lockdown, but we're also going through a lack of our building. So we are not going to be allowed to use the building, as far as we know, until the end of March, because the school has some things they needed to use the aula for. So unfortunately, we are not going to be able to use that for times of worship. But that does not cancel the church, okay? So generally the plan between now and through March, we're going to be doing two things. First thing is we're going to have our online services. Every Sunday we're going to have an online service for you, okay? So just find it on Facebook, find it on our YouTube channel, and also help us get others to watch that as well, others to experience what you're experiencing, others to get fed in the Word. So help us by pushing that out, sending those links out, inviting people to join in the online service. The second thing is, and this is maybe even, I would say this is more important than the online service, is getting together in groups as family or home groups, okay? You know, honestly, the church is not just a teaching or just a time of singing songs. It is more than what we can produce online, okay? It's more than what we can broadcast through Facebook or social media or anything like that. The church is not a service. It is you and it is me gathering together in the name of the Lord. And so we want to keep doing that. We want to do that through home groups and family groups, whatever you feel most comfortable with. And I would encourage you to do that. I want to read something for you. This is from Hebrews chapter 10, verse 23 through 25. And I really hope this will kind of carry us through the next few months as we're kind of navigating through online and home groups. And it goes like this. It says, "Let us hold unswervingly, without moving, to the hope that we profess. For He, Jesus, who promised, is faithful. And let us consider how we may spur one another on to love and good deeds, not giving up meeting together, as some are in the habit of doing, but encouraging one another, and all the more as you see the day approaching." Good words for us, good things to stand on. Just briefly, you know, gather together as a family group or a home group and just make a commitment that every Sunday you're going to gather together with some people, some other believers, other disciples of Jesus, and you're just going to profess the hope that you have in Him. You're going to hold on to that hope together, okay? Don't be an island. Don't be by yourself. Don't be isolated. Be together. Hold on to Jesus. Profess Jesus. Declare Jesus together every Sunday, okay? Second thing, push each other on. Spur each other on to love, you know, and to good deeds. So say, you know, we need that encouragement of just, hey, let's get into this. Let's get into Jesus. Let's get into being His hands and feet in our community, in our sphere of influence. Let's do that. We need to do that. Third thing I get from this is, you know, we all have habits. And unfortunately, in COVID time, we are forming some bad habits, you know, and that even touches us spiritually and even touches us as a church. Let us not form the bad habit talked about here of not meeting together. But let's form the good habit of, hey, I'm going to be in the habit of meeting, and I'm going to meet every Sunday. I'm going to meet throughout the week with people who love Jesus just like you, just like me, right? And get together with the purpose, as it says here, to encourage one another, to put courage into each other. You know, honestly, this whole COVID season has been a roller coaster, a lot of fears, a lot of craziness, And we need courage. We need to, but sometimes we are not feeling very courageous, and that's why we need each other, just to remind each other of the hope that we profess in Jesus Christ. And I just encourage you, let's make a commitment. Weekly, gather together in homes, join together, pray for one another, prophesy over one another, pray for healings, pray for deliverance, pray for courage. Share your testimony. Share what the living God is doing in your life. Just be there. Be a community of Jesus and make a habit of doing that. Commit to doing that as a fellowship. Honestly, it is your responsibility, okay? It is your responsibility to get out there and do that. It's not something that I can make you do. I can just encourage you and make a little video like this and tell you, hey, this is a good thing. But you got to decide in your heart, hey, I want that. I want to be encouraged. I want to be spurred on to love and good deeds. I want to gather together with others to profess Jesus. It's all on you guys. But it is all on you. However, you don't need to do it alone. If you need help, I'm happy to help. Ivetka's happy, Lubos, other guys, we're happy to support these home groups and get them going, support you guys as family. We're happy to come out to your home and just, lead things. So please make a commitment to gathering. A couple things we need help with is for these online services, we need some help to create the content. It's a little bit boring to hear me all the time, okay? We want more voices, more faces in the mix. So if you can help out, and please do offer your services, or I'm going to contact you. And if I contact you, just say, yes, and go for it. Help us out. We need some content creators. Secondly, and you guys got gifts. The Holy Spirit's using you guys. So use those gifts and help us create these online services. By the way, these services are touching way more people than just our regular City Light community that meets together in person. It's touching people all over here in the city and beyond. So it's really, really a good thing. So aside from content creation, we also need some help with just feedback. If you're watching and you say, hey, this could be tweaked a little bit, or hey, I'm watching, just even that you're watching so we know who's watching, and just kind of, we need some general feedback so we know what's going on and how we can improve and be better. Okay, so content creation, a little bit of feedback, that's kind of one thing. The second thing is, commit to gathering together, okay? Open up your home. Some of you guys have the gift of hospitality. Open up your home. Be bold. Invite people to come in. If you want to use our City Light Messenger group, or if you want some emails or contacts, just let me know. Just be bold. Do it. You don't need permission. You got permission. Do it. Okay. Also, if you maybe you don't have a home that you can invite people over, but you want to join a group, do it. Do it. Just say, hey, I want to join a group. I need someone, somewhere to go. Where can I go? Identify yourself and join in, okay? And guys, I understand during this time, it is way more difficult, takes much more effort to open up your homes or go to someone else's home than it is just to show up at the church building. But you know what? This is the season that we've got to do it this way. Be bold. Go for it. Okay, guys, that's the vision for the next few months here in 2021. I hope you understand. Hope you know that we're doing this with the best of intentions. And as the situation changes, we will be changing. We will be adjusting. But we got to be flexible. There's this, it's the kind of 11th unofficial commandment. Blessed are the flexible, for they will not break. Okay? It's not biblical, but it's true. Okay? So, anyways, God bless you guys. Have a wonderful week. And just check out these announcements here. Take care. God bless you guys.